Hey everybody, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany, for those of you who do not know. Today is the second video of the Wash series where we will be talking all about shame. But if you have not watched my first one that talks about insecurity, I highly recommend that you watch that first or else you may be a bit confused in certain parts of this video. So without further ado, let's get into it. As usual, my notes are going to be to the side of me just in case I keep going like this throughout the video. And also, don't forget to check out the description box. I'm going to have a ton of resources down there for you guys to help you kind of work through this further. So the first thing that I really want to talk about is the woman caught in adultery, because I think that something really interesting happened in that story. So if you don't know what that story is or where you can find it in the Bible, it's actually John 8 verses 1 through 4, and then verses 10 through 11 are going to be my focus for this video. So we know that in the beginning, these men, all right, they carried this woman, or they brought this adulterous woman to Jesus, and essentially was kind of like testing how he would, you know, interact with this woman that was seen as disgusting in this society. She was seen as, you know, less than. I'm pretty sure many people did not want to marry her because she was seen as ran through or damaged goods. But Jesus did something so incredible, in my opinion. And I think that what he did is something that a lot of us forget is also done for us, even though he isn't physically here anymore. Verses 10 through 11 really stood out to me because it says, when Jesus had raised himself up. Okay, let me backtrack. Before verses 10 through 11, Jesus posed the question. Well, Jesus said to them, you know, whoever is without sin may cast the first stone. And obviously no one stood up because none of us are perfect, right? And so in verses 10 through 11, you see the Lord, he redirects his attention to the woman who at this point is probably terrified. You know, I can just imagine the kinds of things that were going on in her mind. So the scripture says that when Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." And I think that that is such a powerful, powerful statement, because right off bat, when we begin to feel shame, which is something that, you know, I believe the devil tries to implant in us so that we can keep ourselves further away from the Lord, he already says outright that there is no condemnation. There is no condemnation, no matter what you've done, no matter what you've partaken in, no matter what you've said, no matter what, right? The Lord does not condemn you. And I think that that's really important to note, because even when we look back at Eve, right? How last week we were just talking about the events leading up to Eve feeling insecure. Immediately when her and Adam heard the voice of the Lord, there was shame that came in there, without a doubt. And that shame came down immediately because she not only felt like she let herself down, but that she let down her creator. She let down her husband out of a temporary moment that wasn't so satisfying after all, right? So there are a few things that we can look at just at Eve's story alone. The first thing that she experienced was fear. She was afraid to interact with the Lord once she heard his voice because she realized that she was naked. Two, she tried to hide herself. And I know, obviously, now if we woke up somewhere and we realized our entire body was exposed, a lot of us would try our hardest to find whatever we can to cover ourselves back up. But you have to remember that during this time, there were no clothes on them. They were free, right? And they were blind to Their nakedness. And a lot of times when people refer to this nakedness, obviously it can be physical, but a lot of times people interpret this as being more of a metaphor, right? Being naked before God, being completely exposed in every way before God. So first, she experiences that fear that, oh shoot, the Lord is gonna know what I've done. And then she hides herself because she's embarrassed, because she's disappointed, and because she did not, you know, immediately run to the Father and accept his warm embrace. Just like today, when we go and do something that we see as shameful, we don't go and tell anyone about it most of the time, right? Usually, the way that that looks is we sin, we do something that we know, we shouldn't, or we do something that we know we're trying to get away from, and then we're so embarrassed that we keep coming back to this point, that we keep stumbling, that we keep falling, that we keep doing things that are seen as defiled, and then we go and hide ourselves instead of clinging on to that community and clinging on to Jesus. And what that does is way worse than just going to someone and saying like, hey sis, hey bro, hey leader, hey Lord, I messed up. It's way worse. Isolating yourself is always worse, because that isolation is the devil's playing ground, right? That's something that people say, at least where I am, a lot now. But it's really true. I know even in my life, when I was going through a season where I just could not for the life of me break out of this bondage that I was in, I would do my dirt. I would go to my room. I would lock myself in my room, not speak to anybody, just sit there and cry. But the thing is, I wasn't giving those tears to the Lord. I was crying. And those tears were completely just falling into my lap. And every single time, Satan was able to speak all of these lies about my character and about my identity to me, until I got to a point where I was just like, I came into agreement with those things, where I started to feel like I am dirty. I am less than. I am not deserving of the Lord's love. And if we aren't careful in being proactive when it comes to learning how to fight well in these spaces, we can easily completely fall away from the faith. That self-condemnation can a lot of times be projected onto the church, onto our leaders, onto our friends, in our relationships, whether they're romantic or not. They can be projected in all of these areas, and that can be used to really make us want to step away from the church itself, but also the people who are associated with the church. Because it can seem like every time I look at you, I'm reminded of my sin. I'm reminded of all of these things that I'm being told that I can't do, or things that were out of my control that happened to me. And I even want to harp on that for a second, because I know a lot of times things that are out of our control may happen, right? And instead of realizing that we were a victim in that moment, we start to blame ourselves. And we start to say, well, because this thing happened to me, I must be the problem. Because this thing happened to me, the Lord must not love me. Because this thing happened to me, I could not possibly be worthy of living a life like all of these people that I see around me, like all of these people that I see on social media, on TV, that I read about in books. I could not possibly be anything like them. But it's like we almost forget about the stories in the Bible, where these people came from. The Lord always draws the most unlikely, and he uses them so greatly. Mary Magdalene was someone who the Lord loved. She walked closely with the Lord. She served Jesus. She served him. But if we look at her before all of those miraculous moments, right? This was a woman who had multiple spirits inside of her, multiple dark spirits inside of her. But the Lord healed her, and he was then able to use her. And not even use her for her works, but he was able to love her. He was able to do life with her. He was able to walk through different seasons with her. And that is exactly what the Lord wants to do with us. He wants to be able to take that thing, discard of it, and begin the mind renewal process, begin the healing process. You don't have to walk that out without the Lord. Healing is not meant to be walked through without Jesus. It's not. And something else that I think is so profound is Psalm 31 verse 1, right? It says, a psalm of David, in you, O Lord, I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Deliver me in your righteousness. That's something that you can speak over yourself even now. Get those sticky notes out and plaster them up against your wall. Show you, like, finding scriptures that speak to the beauty of your character. The beauty that the Lord knows exists that you cannot see yet. Speaking those things over yourself, praying and asking the Lord to help you to see yourself the way that he sees you. I am telling you from experience, the Lord will open your eyes so brightly and show you so many things that have been lying dormant inside of you, that have just been waiting for you to come into submission and be like, yeah, I am worthy of fill in the blank. Sometimes it really is that simple. But also, even just looking at Psalm 37:4, right? That is a verse that just speaks to, you know, asking of the Lord and him giving you the desires of your heart. And I want to stay here for a little minute because I think that a lot of times that we can read that scripture and focus heavily on the latter half that says God will give me the desires of my heart. So if I have been feeling shame, if I've been feeling rejected, if I have been feeling a void of any sort, we typically like to ask God for that material thing, right? For that job, for that scholarship, for that internship, for that relationship, for that opportunity, right? Oh my gosh, he will give you the abundantly and above all that you can ever ask, think, or imagine. That is a different scripture. But that ties so beautifully into this because it says that he's going to give you the desires of your heart. So really, you may be asking for this material possession, but it's because of this void that you have lying in you and you're looking for this material thing to fill it. But the Lord is saying that's not going to fill it. And a great example of this is looking at Rachel. In Genesis 29 verses 31 through 35, this had me in tears when I read it, okay? Because the story of Jacob, Rachel, and Leah, all right? Jacob went to their father's house and he seen Rachel and she was beautiful, drop dead gorgeous. And so he wanted to marry her. He made his intentions known and he worked. He served in her father's house for 7 years just so that he could make her his wife. But what had happened was the father, on the wedding night, the father granted him the eldest daughter named Leah. Now, Leah was not that attractive. She was not that desirable to Jacob, but he consummated their marriage. So he was tied to her, but he did not love her. He loved Rachel. So he stayed another 7 years working for this man for 14 years just to get Rachel. The pursuit of Rachel was so heavy, right? On one hand, that's cute. But then you have to consider his first wife, Leah, the one whom he did not love. And so the Lord seen that she was unloved and he opened her womb. And so he gave her her first child. And she said, I have this baby. Now I know Jacob will love me. Got pregnant a second time. She said, I have this baby. Now he must adore me. The third time, I have this baby. Now I must be worthy. The fourth time, she finally said, "I have this baby." And she gave thanks to the Lord. She looked back finally to her father, and she never conceived again. The Lord closed her womb. And the reason why that story is so, so rich and so powerful is because we oftentimes are just like Leah. A lot of the times we ask for this thing, or the Lord sees that we're missing something. He tries to give us what we're desiring. And then we say, okay, I received this thing from the Lord, but now the people that I'm looking to fill me, the voids that I'm looking to fill, they must be taken care of. But then the issue comes back. The problem comes back. And so we keep going back to the Lord saying, "Lord, Lord, I need. And really, he's just saying, "Daughter, all you need is to sit at my feet. It's to sit at my feet and listen to what I've said about you. And stop looking around at all of these other people." And it's in that moment when, from a spiritual standpoint, the shame begins to lift. Don't try to do this healing alone. Speak to your sisters in Christ. If you don't have anyone to speak to, DM me. Because sometimes we really do still need, in conjunction with the Word of God, we need a sister to encourage us. One, begin to recognize where they came from. So like I was saying, a lot of the times we may think that, oh, I feel like crap because I keep getting rejected from these internships, when really you don't feel like you are qualified to go into that area until someone else validates you by giving you a job offer. But at the root of things, the Lord is trying to get you to see that you literally are more than enough. You are so intelligent, you're so bright, and you're so capable. So sit with the Lord. This can be done through prayer. It can be done through talking with people. A lot of times you will just find out, like, oh, I'm actually kind of sad that X, Y, and Z happened years ago that I thought I was over, but I'm still clinging on to it. So you cannot skip this step. Through prayer, through reading the Word of God, through listening to sermons. I even have some listed down below for you guys that I've personally watched when I've walked through certain seasons of my life. Then the second thing is to learn what God says about shame. Learn about the scriptures. Isaiah 54:4 is a great one. You can speak that over yourself, right? It even says, like, "Do not fear, for you will not be ashamed." That's just a teeny tiny bit of that verse. So really get in your prayer closet, in your quiet time with the Lord. Start looking up these scriptures. You can literally Google, what does the Bible say about shame? Write them down in your notebook. Write them down on your phone. Make it your wallpaper. Do whatever you need to do so where you can see that thing and remind yourself that the Lord does not put me to shame. That is not of God, and therefore I do not come into agreement with that thing. And then the last thing, of course, is to seek godly counsel. I am going to say this probably at the end of every single video because it is so important. It's so imperative. When it comes to counsel, you can look to your church leaders. You can look to counseling. You can look to therapy. Counseling and therapy are a little different. People typically use this interchangeably, but they are not the same thing. And I think a lot of times people, they completely write off therapy and counseling because they went to the wrong one and therefore it wasn't beneficial for them. Counseling is meant to be short term, okay? Therapy is where you go if you need someone to walk with you a bit more closely. And within that, you have the ability to go to behavioral therapy or clinical therapy, which is like your psychiatrist who can prescribe medication to you. Now, if you're not comfortable with being prescribed medication, I know that it has so many so many side effects in a lot of people. You can start off with the behavioral route and commit yourself to seeing this person. And if you're someone who says like, man, I really, really, really want to, begin doing therapy, but I don't have the money for that, or like my insurance doesn't cover that, you can reach out to me and I can work with you to see what resources are available in your area. But I just want you guys to do whatever it is necessary so that you can begin to overcome this thing. Because a lot of times, by the time that shame shows up, we have let other things fester and build up inside of us to the point where now, like, that shame is at the forefront. But really, that's one single layer to a lot of different things. And that's why I'm doing this series, you guys. I pray that even after this video, if you are feeling the Lord tugging you to, you know, come and sit with me, go do that. Don't ignore the voice of the Lord, even if it's for 5 minutes. Those little things matter in the grand scheme of your healing. Be encouraged. You will not be in this place forever. You will not be in this place forever. I believe that. I know that. I've walked through it. You can do this. And I will see you next week, where we will be talking all about trauma. But until then, bye, guys.